ICC Commission on E-Business, IT and Telecommunication, and it's my distinct pleasure to moderate this workshop here, which is hosted by the Finnish government. And it's, on a personal note, I think coincidentally the very same day when my eldest daughter gets her stuff together to move to Finland. I don't know why they picked this time of the year to go to Finland, but I realized that the school that she's visiting is 10 times better equipped when it comes to the use of ICT than what we usually have in Germany, which I think is another recognition that the government of Finland must have done a lot of things right in order to promote the use of ICT. And I hope that when I'm out of India, I can use voice over IP to connect with my daughter and stay in touch with her. So these are the credits for the Finnish government, and thanks again for making this workshop possible. Those who are sitting in the back of the room, I would like to invite you to come closer to give this a workshop atmosphere, because we want to keep this as interactive and as lively as possible, and when we can see you and can be in touch with you, that is easier as if you are somewhere in the dark part of this room here. It's my great pleasure to welcome the panelists for this workshop. From your perspective, left-hand side, my right-hand side, it's Helani Galpaya, the Director for Strategic Development of Lirnesia in Sri Lanka. She is, since many years, very active in all different areas of ICT development with a special focus on telecom. And this is the main reason, I guess, why we wanted you to be here today, focusing on the bottom of the pyramid and how they can take advantage of these developments. On her right-hand side, a member of the Finnish Parliament, Jyrki Kasvi, Vice Chair of the Committee for the Future of the Finnish Parliament. He is also the President of the International Parliamentarians Association for Information Technology, and with his PhD in engineering, an expert on the kind of topics that we are discussing here. And to my left, Natarajan Sivasamban, the global head of telecom, media, and entertainment practice of Tata Consultancy Services. You see, we have academics, we have the politicians, the government, and the business here on this panel. We don't have the small, medium businesses, but I will make sure that their special requirements are constantly kept in mind while we discuss this, because that's the focus of our workshop today, to discuss convergence, which we are all very familiar with, but this time more from the socioeconomic aspect, in particular with regards to the benefits beyond the technologies for the SMEs and what the role is of the public in order to promote this. And in order to get into the discussion and the debate, which we will try to keep as open as possible and as interactive as possible, I would like to start with asking Helani, from this perspective, what does digital convergence really mean in the real life of a citizen in an emerging market?
I think the traditional developed world or Western narrative of digital convergence always, well, most of the time, involves a fat pipe that is coming to your home or your business, carrying multiple streams of data that can be video, voice, just simple data, and so on. In the developing world, that fat pipe, or fiber to the home, or a very fast XDSL or whatever connection, the fat pipe is not very common. It is only common in the big cities or for the big businesses. And there you will have the phenomenon of multiple modes of communication coming through one pipe, maybe into one device even. When you move down in the socioeconomic strata, what you have is things converging on a different type of device, and that's mobile phone. That is the most commonly accessible and usable device, digital device, that people have, especially people at the bottom of the pyramid or even the middle class people. They use it, they have access to it, and they can afford it. And increasingly, what you have is these groups of people consuming more than voice on the mobile phone, including internet browsing, Or you have these hybrid forms of convergence where you will have, you know, a truly global player. For example, you know, one guy sitting in Sri Lanka running a tourist business based on selling tree huts. He has tourists come there from various European countries, and he sells his services through an online website. So there are services provided to him, like credit card payments that he gets. So that's, in a very traditional way, e-commerce on a web. But he lives 2 kilometers from the nearest internet access point. Back in the day, he used to get on his bike and travel, you know, half an hour or 1 hour or whatever it was to come and check his email every day, and he doesn't get a booking every day. Now he has a kind of this hybrid convergence where he gets an SMS when there's a booking, or he gets an SMS when he needs to check his email, and then he gets on his bike and he goes. Ideally, he would use his, you know, mobile device to do that, but the speeds aren't that good. So these hybrid convergence models, which are very mobile phone-based, is sort of the future for the bottom of the pyramid and maybe the lower middle class and lower income strata in the developing world, we think.
Thank you. Siva, the fat pipe, as you described, is a place where do make their profits when it comes to telecommunication. You are in charge of a for-profit telecom organization. How do you roll still can make profit, and if not, why are you doing this?
Yeah. First of all, from a convergence point of view, for us, it's about a network that's IP-based, a network that is interoperable at both the core and the access networks, interoperable devices, and finally, a common set of systems and processes that can support this multi-network environment. So that's what we are looking at from a convergence point of view. I would tend to agree with Hilani that when it comes to bandwidth availability, I guess it's a feature of any growth market that most of the major cities or the metros, as we call it, you do have reasonably good bandwidth availability. But then the moment you go to the interiors, 200 kilometers in from Hyderabad, you'll have this problem. In Hyderabad, you'll not have this problem. So. There is a huge opportunity for operators in the country for them to roll out networks, and each of them is looking at rolling out network. We have constraints of both regulatory constraints, but for that, I think the operators are ready to roll out networks. When I talk about the Tatas itself, we do have a fairly national presence when it comes to our mobile operations. We are also rolling out WiMAX networks in some of the cities. We are looking at WiMAX as a means to provide a bigger bandwidth on mobile, because then last mile isn't an issue. So A, as a solution to last mile, B, as a better bandwidth solution, we are looking at rolling out WiMAX networks.
Yuki, I gave lots of praise to the Finnish government based on my own experiences here. What is it that the government can do in order to promote this, and where is the area where, based on your experiences, the limitations are too obvious and it needs to be managed elsewhere but should not be in the hands of the administration to drive the development of convergence?
Thank you, and first let me correct a little thing that at the moment I'm the ex-president of IPAI. The torch has been passed on since we last discussed. It's now on the Bulgarian hands. But I believe that the role of the government and regulation is kind of setting a fair framework of operations for businesses and particularly SMEs and also public services, because if you leave it totally unregulated, then you may have a situation like we had in Finland when it came to healthcare computer systems, when municipalities were liberated in the 1980s. The government was believing that the local authorities know best what's best for them. And so they didn't, for example, tell them what kind of computer systems they should buy to their hospitals. So each and every municipality